that makes you worthwhile. You were worthwhile in the pre-existence, you're worthwhile here. So you're not here to prove your worth. Now, as you look at that, if you believe performance equals worth, then your performance, other people's performance determine your worth, all of a sudden you're going to be doing codependent behaviors because of that belief. So if I ask you questions now, for instance, what would the girl in the backseat do if she were not codependent? See, you know the answer now. Say, forget it, Buster. Or the same school teacher who's not codependent and the students aren't doing well, she can love them. He can love them now. And teach them and work with them. And be understanding and compassionate. So let's look for just a second at what the prophet Joseph Smith said as we move into our list of the differences between what the gospel teaches and what codependency teaches. The prophet Joseph Smith said, I teach people correct principles and they govern themselves. That is the opposite of codependency. So if you go to 2 Nephi chapter 2, you'll find some scriptures that teach us to not be codependent. Let's look at a couple of these. Let's look at verse 14. And now, my sons, I speak unto you these things for your profit and learning. For there is a God, and he hath created all things, both the heavens and the earth, and all things that in them are, both things to act and things to be acted upon. The gospel of Jesus Christ teaches us to act, not to be acted upon. Acted upon is codependency. The scripture could have said, both things to act or to be codependent. It doesn't say that, but it's the same concept. Wherefore the Lord God gave unto man, verse 16, that he should act for himself. Wherefore man could not act for himself, save it should be that he was enticed by one or the other. 26:27. The Messiah cometh in the fullness of time, that he may redeem the children of men from the fall. And because that they are redeemed from the fall, they have become free forever. That's the freedom of the gospel, not the bondage of codependency. Knowing good from evil, to act for themselves, and not to be acted upon. Save it be by the punishment of the law at the great and last day, according to the commandments which God hath given. And notice verse 27, it's one of the greatest scriptures in all scripture. Wherefore men are free according to the flesh, and all things are given them which are expedient unto man. And they are free to choose liberty and eternal life through the great mediation of all men, or to choose captivity and death according to the captivity and power of the devil, for he seeketh that all men might be miserable like unto himself. Ask any codependent if they're happy, and you'll get a very specific answer, and a very clear answer if they're very honest. They'll say no. And in that same chapter, it says men are that they might have joy. You see, what that chapter talks about is how to be happy, how to act rather than being acted upon. So with our list then, I'll give you what the gospel teaches, and I'll give you what codependency teaches, and we'll go through find the list. Number one, the gospel teaches to live to please the Lord. What's the greatest commandment? Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and thy neighbor as thyself. There's three commandments there. Love the Lord, love your neighbor, love yourself. Codependency teaches to live to please other people. Literally, it teaches that. The gospel teaches to help others to govern themselves. The gospel teaches us to put free agency on other people and help them to govern themselves. Codependency teaches us to rely on another person. Just exactly the opposite. So if you go to Romans chapter 7, there's some of the greatest scriptures on love. But codependency teaches, before we read that scripture, to try to get love from other people and to literally, brothers and sisters, to manipulate and control other people so they will love you. That's what codependency teaches. So notice what the scriptures teach on love, the opposite of codependency. It says, what is it that you shall hope for? See, codependency doesn't give us hope. It gives us fear, gives us depression, gives us all kinds of fear. Behold, I say unto you that you shall have hope through the atonement of Christ and the power of his resurrection to be raised to life eternal, and this because of your faith in him according to the promise. This is verse 41 in Romans chapter 7. 45, in charity, those are the qualities. Suffereth long, is kind, envieth not, is not puffed up, seeketh not her own, is not easily provoked, thinketh no evil, rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in the truth, beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, endureth all things. And it says, my beloved brethren, if ye have not charity, you are nothing, for charity never faileth. Wherefore, cleave unto charity, which is the greatest of all, for all things must fail. But charity is a pure love of Christ, and it endureth forever. And it talks about us. Whoso shall be found possessed of it at the last day, it shall be well with him. And that's us. Well, the gospel teaches us to love people with a Christ-like love, and that's what we can do. Also, the gospel teaches us to focus on helping others to be more self-reliant through the guidance of the Spirit. That's the whole principle of the welfare system. Teach people to be self-reliant and have the Spirit guide you to help them. But codependency teaches us to focus on helping others even at the expense of others. Even at the expense of guess who? Yourself. So I'm sacrificing myself, that's okay. Well, you know, that's the opposite of what Moroni chapter 10 teaches us, where it says don't run faster than you have strength. Codependents will just go and go, destroy their health, emotionally, physically, because I've got to help you. What the codependent is really doing is working so hard to get that approval that it becomes more important than their health. Gospel teachings are based on gospel doctrine. Seems pretty obvious. But codependency teachings are based on member teachings. And I won't go into that now except to refer you to the book Stress Reduction for Mormons and the audio tape, which talk in detail about member teachings. All I want to say here is that there's gospel teachings that are always true and always accurate, like the atonement. There's member teachings that are sometimes true and oftentimes false. They're created by members. And I just want you to know, for the purposes of this talk right now, tonight, brothers and sisters, that codependency and the fostering of it are member teachings, not gospel teachings. The gospel teaches us to help others to be more reliant on Christ. 2 Nephi 25:23, by the grace of Christ, we are saved after all we can do. But codependent teaches us to help others to be more reliant on another person, or even reliant on themselves to the point of pride. Reverend McKay says, self-reliance is a virtue, but with it should come the realization of the need for a higher power. That's gospel teaching. Codependent teaching, how a leader, for instance, may give in to what a member wants, even when it's not for their own good, because you need the person to like you. The gospel teaches a member gospel doctrine and to love and lean on Jesus Christ. Section 19. Learn of me and listen to my words. Walk in the meekness of my spirit, and you shall have peace in me. But codependency teaches a person to lean on and be impressed with the wisdom or personality of the leader, the teacher. So it's a totally different approach. Well, the missionary may teach the person to love the missionary without even knowing it. There's a codependent relationship formed, and we've all heard it. So when the missionary leaves, the person may go inactive. Why? Because they're committed to the missionary. They love the missionary. That's fine to love the missionary, but the missionary needs to teach the person to look beyond their personality and love Jesus Christ. Moroni chapter 10, if you go to the end of the Book of Mormon, in the last few verses, is just perfect for what the gospel teaches. Moroni chapter 10, verse 32. Yea, come unto Christ and be perfected in him, and deny yourselves of all ungodliness. And if ye shall deny yourselves of all ungodliness, Jesus and love God with all your might, mind, and strength. Then is his grace sufficient for you, that by his grace you may be perfect in Christ. And if by the grace of God you are perfect in Christ, you can in no wise deny the power of God. And again, if ye by the grace of God are perfect in Christ and deny not his power, then are ye sanctified in Christ by the grace of God through the shedding of the blood of Christ, which is in the covenant of the Father unto the remission of sins, that ye become holy without spot. So that's the gospel of Jesus Christ. A gospel teacher loves his or her students, as a gospel teaches, with a Christ-like love, teaching them gospel doctrine and to place their faith in Christ. But the codependent teacher works hard to teach students, extremely hard, folks, to be successful so he or she can feel successful. He wants them to stay active in the church so that you don't fail. This person may express much love, but what the students feel is different than that love. The students feel something different because it's diluted by codependency. We had some orange juice yesterday that had about four times too much water in it. You ever tasted it like that? Well, it kind of tastes like orange juice, but it's so yucky you'd rather have plain water. And that's a little bit what codependency is like. It's so watered down that there's still a touch of the gospel there, but you'd rather have water. Well, the gospel teaches us that we must live worthy to have the Spirit, while a codependent may be living worthily, and many are, but it's not necessary to be worthy to be a codependent. In fact, codependency does not provide a healing or a sanctifying influence in a person's life. It is unable to do that. But the gospel of Jesus Christ teaches us that as we follow the Spirit and serve through the Spirit, we can then provide a healing and sanctifying influence in the person's life. Doctrine and Covenants 20, verse 31, that we're sanctified through grace. Now, the gospel teaches us that gospel service provides an ability to deeply love a person even when he sins or fails. In other words, you learn how to separate the person from the behavior. You can love the person and hate the behavior. But the gospel teaches us that the Lord does this to us, doesn't he? He loves you, loves me, no matter what mistakes we make, and he loves all of us. And the behavior doesn't determine it. Now, the behavior determines consequences, but it doesn't determine love. But for the codependent, they may resent those who do not succeed and judge them harshly if they fail. They may still verbalize that love, but they come across in an incongruent way, which may or may not be detected by the person. So sometimes a person will say things like, I don't know, he confuses me. Because they're getting double messages. The messages are, I'm supposed to say I love you because I teach you, and because I'm your priesthood leader or whatever, but I don't feel it. And so you get a double message from people. Learning more about a person's problems in the gospel leads to understanding and needed inspiration to help the person. The more you learn about them, the more the Lord helps you to help them, the more you love them. But what if what you're learning is negative? Well, under codependency, you learn more about a person's problems and you get confused, you have more anxiety, you become more judgmental, and you develop attitudes that cause you to judge the person and to separate you from them. So they feel more distant rather than accepted and loved. The gospel teaches us to help others with a spirit that leads to changed lives. People get close to Christ in this teaching. Codependency, helping others as a codependent leads, would you believe it, to anxiety, to frustration, for both the giver and the receiver, so people move away from Christ and his teachings. The gospel teaches us to understand the difference between a sin and a weakness, and we'll talk about this more under solutions. The codependent teaches a person that weaknesses and sins are the same thing. The gospel of Jesus Christ doesn't enable us, doesn't rescue us from the consequences of our behavior, but codependence enables all the time. We've defined that already. The gospel of Jesus Christ, a person is aware of his or her own behaviors, but the codependent will tend to have a lot of denial about their behaviors, especially And so, the gospel of Jesus Christ, the person isn't easily manipulated by other people. So you might try to manipulate me, but I care too much about me or I care too much about you to allow you to do that. But the codependent is a whole different ballgame. I need you so much, see, that you can now easily manipulate me, and I may even know you're doing it and still allow you to do it as a codependent. The gospel of Jesus Christ person is a peacemaker, yet deals with inevitable conflicts that come into all of our lives. The person living the gospel will learn how to deal with inevitable conflicts that come, but that person will deal with those in a Christ-like way. The person on codependency just can't stand conflict. They have to avoid it. Conflict, see, becomes bad. Conflict means I'm bad. So if I have a conflict, then that means I'm a bad person to the codependent, because remember, performance equals worth. Conflict is bad, therefore if I have conflict, I'm not performing well, and you can see how that fits in there. And so one of the most important things, for instance, about codependency, as we look at it, is the difference between what we allow people to do to us. For instance, the gospel teaches us not to allow another person to abuse us. But a codependent will not only allow a person to abuse her, for instance, but she will believe it when she's told she causes his abusive behavior. She will believe it when she's told that she causes him to drink. She causes him to have the affair. She causes him to not come to church. Whatever it is, she believes it because she needs him to approve of her so much that she will accept those messages, even though they're outright lies. But the gospel teaches us to feel anger and then to be able to let go of it. But codependency teaches us to deny anger, stuff it in, then victimize and blame other people for our negative feelings. Notice the process, how opposite that is of the gospel. The gospel teaches us to be responsible for our own behaviors and sins, to repent of them and put them behind us. And one of my favorite quotes is a quote by Brigham Young that illustrates this concept. Brigham Young said, "I do not recollect that I've seen 5 minutes since I was baptized that I have not been able to preach a funeral sermon, lay hands on the sick, or to pray in private or in public." And notice what he says. "I will tell you the secret of this. In all your business transactions, words, and communications, if you commit an overt act, repent of that immediately and call upon God to deliver you from evil and give you the light of his spirit. Never do anything that your conscience and the light within you tells you is wrong. Never do a wrong, but do all the good that you possibly can," he said. "Never do a thing to mar the peaceable influence of the Holy Spirit in you. Then, whatever you are engaged in, whether in business, in the dance, or in the pulpit, you are ready to officiate at any time in any of the ordinances of the house of God." And I love his summary statement. "If I commit an overt act, the Lord knows the integrity of my heart, and through sincere repentance, he forgives me." That's a powerful statement, because what he's teaching is we all make mistakes, but get them behind you quickly, get the light of the Spirit, and move on. Now, the codependence teaches us to blame ourselves for all our own behaviors, mistakes, personal responsibility becomes exaggerated. We get stuck in the past, we get stuck with our sins, and instead of letting go of it and moving on, we blame ourselves for our mistakes and get stuck.